Hello and welcome to Last on the Breaks. This week, coming to you once again from lockdown, audio visual as well. We are, of course, the MotoGP podcast, currently trying to bring you some of the best deep dive interviews into various people in the paddock or previously in the paddock, riders, mechanics, team personnel, legends, like our right honourable guest today. Who have we got on today, Matt?
Well, as your lovely viewers might have realised when you clicked on either the video that you're watching this or perhaps the podcast, it is in fact six times a world champion, four times 250 class consecutively, and a double world superbike champion, Max Biaggi. The guy doesn't really need much of an intro, to be honest. If you know, he's an absolute legend of the sport. He was set to be made a MotoGP legend come the Italian GP this year, but of course that will have been put on hold for the time being. But Max, MotoGP legend, wanted to speak to him not just about his career, because I think given his status in the sport, that would have been done many a times. We wanted some different perspectives, didn't we, Fran?
We did indeed. So we've got a little bit on retirement, adrenaline, when you get thrown in there and you're not really sure what's happening, the difference between the sport then and now, and a few good things as well about what it's like being a team owner, a young rider, working with them as well. I think it's a good deep dive. And then at the end, of course, we have Kenwood Quickfire, putting him on the spot to get some instinctive answers, brought to you by our podcast sponsor and MotoGP communications provider, JVC Kenwood, with all our on-site radios.
Shout out to Kenwood for keeping us going. I really appreciate your support in the podcast. And I hope you guys as well are enjoying the quickfire questions. And something else which actually might find interesting from Biaggi's perspective coming up later, a bit of a teaser. What does a four-time 250cc world champion think about how quickly riders these days move up to MotoGP? Well, tune in later to find out. That must have been a bit weird moving back and forth to the camera.
We're feeling a bit loose today, aren't we? We've done plenty of...
exactly. And with the wallpaper behind me as well, quite jazzy. So, yeah.
Well, lovely.
Enough of us flapping our gums. Well, better get on with the actual podcast. Let's give Max a ring, shall we, with this lovely sunflower
Indeed.
Backdrop. I looked at the footage from 1994 Suzuka at the final corner.
That was
an ambitious move, I gotta say.
Yeah. So as you saw that, I didn't choose something then it put me in a highlight because I won that race. Actually, I finished fourth. But I was thinking that it's nice to people to see. Then even if it was my, you know, one of my first few years of racing, then I was always trying to make it happen, even it was sometimes it was not really possible. But as a young rider, because I was young, you know, it's a privilege to try to never give up, even when it looks impossible. So this is something that, or you got this inside as a rider, or you don't. So, and when I was young, I had this, you know, like Suzuka or like, for example, I don't know, maybe you are too young to remember, but in the same year on Hockenheim, on the, you know, that the last lap, there was a, you know, very, very risky move on the motodrome with the Romboni and Capirossi that was really crazy last lap. Kind of like this, you know. So that was me.
Okay. After you, Fran.
Okay, well, We will talk about your career, of course, but we also, on these podcasts, we want to talk about you and your life, you as a person, a bit more behind the rider, nothing too crazy. But we'll start off. You had quite a unique entrance into the World Championship because you didn't come through the lightweight class, as it was at the time, 125s. You just popped straight into 250s. What was that like, being thrown in at the deep end when you were so young and straight into the intermediate class?
Well, actually, we need to step back a little bit, you know, because when I first joined the motorcycle world, I was already 18 years old. So in the national championship, I was already adult. I mean, was just too big to think to go to the small class in the one day to the World Championship, which is, you know, a class where a rider begin when they are 14, 15. So I was already 18, 19. So I did the national championship in Italy as a sport production, so production machine. And then I went straight to European 250 because with my father, we was thinking we are, you know, you are still too old. So it's better one day if you're class six in a European championship, you move to the World Championship 250. And that was the reason why I did it. Mm. And then I moved when I was, 20. Yeah.
See, I would still say that was very young, but you're like, oh, well, 18, you're an adult. I like that. I find that quite interesting.
Yeah, because if you're looking already in the past 10, 20 years, people starting to go on the bike when they are like 4 or 5 years old. So I was just, I never dreamed to jump on a bike when I was 9 or 10 years. You know, I always thinking to be a football player. So motorcycle was another world for me. So then, so happy then approach, even when I was adult, but still was enough to, you know, to take the best of it.
Who did you look up to when you were trying to come into the 250, into the motorcycle racing world? Who were your heroes at the time, the ones that made you want to do that instead of football?
Yeah, because actually what impressed to me was, you know, remember John Kosicki?
Mm-hmm. Of course.
When he did the wild card in Laguna Seca that year, he won both races, and something that was really something super cool, you know, very strange. Then the guy, then he never raced in the World Championship, make just the wild card and win the both races. And then after that, I was looking to Wayne Rainey. You know, I have a chat with Wayne last week, and I say that to him, you know, I have his poster on my bedroom. So with a Yamaha, you know, number two. And then, you know, after 20 years almost, I have a similar Yamaha with the same sponsor and same number, you know, then I race with. So that was something very, very special.
Was that always a dream then? So like, is this something you always aspired to, or did that just become a happy coincidence and you thought, oh, that's cool?
Well, it's, you know, it's a kind of hero that you had, and that was a dream, a goal. Yeah. You know, to achieve, you know, to have the same kind of same bike, same color, same number. It's a coincidence, of course, but it's like also a small dream come true.
I like that. So obviously you said you were an adult then, we'll take that, when you entered the World Championship, which is quite different to, like you said, some of the guys that enter now, although it's 16 for Moto3 now, unless you're the Sev Moto3 or Rookies Champion. But it's still quite a difference, and a lot in the championships have changed as well. What was it like being an athlete then compared to what you see now, especially through your team?
Well, of course, back then, you know, it was not so very intensive. Also, when you don't start, when you're very young and kids, of course, also your mind is not, the approach is not that technical as when someone teach you when you are very young. So you have the chance to learn, to feel something inside you. So it's kind of teaching, you know. And when we were racing, and also when I think Schwanz, Rainey, Mamola, and the one before, they was very instant, you know. They use the instant mode to ride the bike, you know. Now there is a preparation behind, there is a factory who make the schooling, there is a knowledge. And before it was very more natural, you know, not that technical. Now you can not study to be a rider, but you can be, you know, on the way to understand what you have to do to become a motorcycle rider.
Talk to us a little bit more about the instinct side of it. Is that you just, did you feel that you were able to have, because you had so much success so early on when you're in your full-time career, 250cc, how much of that do you put down to just your raw instinct and raw talent, as opposed to maybe the work ethic, technical side that you see now?
Well, also the preparation now is it's amazing. You know, before, you know, I remember back to 1995, 1996. Actually, Mick Doohan was a really athlete. He was like doing a triathlon. There was high preparation, and also me coming from the soccer division, you know, I had the kind of backup of you know, working on physical situation very, very hard. You know, while many other people, they, you know, I remember it was people who was smoking on the glass. It was very different, very, very. We are talking about 30 years ago, where it was very spontaneous. You know, many riders were just doing some small thing, but not really working themselves. Now, in the past 10, 20 years, you can see you can prove your potential, your, you know, your body condition much, much more than before. So by knowing, then you can work on this specific part of your body, or you can do this other, you know, there is so many techniques. So this is important and make riders much more closer also, because before someone was doing something, someone was doing nothing. So, and the gap, you see the gap. Plus, if you have a talent or not, but this is a kind of plus point, you know.
So how do you think you would do now if you entered the championship today? How do you think you would find that different world? Do you think it would be tougher, or do you think you still would have had your background and you would have found it the same?
Well, I cannot imagine myself to be back on the field again. No, no way. But by knowing my riders, when the approach they have, I see they are very, very high professional, you know, in the way they eat, in the way they prepare the race, in the way they do things at home. So it's a proper full-day job, you know. And never stop, you know. It was a kind of the same, similar for me, but now they're much more, maybe what they're doing now in Moto3, we was doing before when we were doing a MotoGP or 500cc. So, but now it's even small class, they're really, you know, they're doing the heavy job that we was doing before.
Do you, when looking back at those sorts of times, I got to tell you that I was actually born in 1994, so the year of your first world championship, so I didn't see it at the time.
Yeah, you make me feel very old.
But
me too, eh? Even me too.
But looking back, and when you hear people talk about that sort of era and any era before it, people viewed athletes, particularly motorcycle racing athletes, as real sort of superheroes. Whereas now I feel that the average fan wants to see those riders as superheroes, but they want to be more relatable to them. They want to see that they're almost ordinary guys doing amazing things. What did you feel your perception of was, or what the fans, how they viewed you, especially in your first couple of years in the World Championship?
Well, you know, yeah, they feel like you're kind of a superhero, you know, like a guy that does crazy stuff, and the most of the people who are not motorcycle fans, they was looking of us as crazy guys. They were doing something amazing, but how you can do this? There was not so much thinking about. Then behind this, there is a preparation. There is a proper team. There is a proper factory. There is all people involved. So it's before was not so. There is not so much knowledge also about people who watching maybe television. Now TV really go inside details and show you the little things that you don't even can imagine if you are not a part of the motorcycle world, you know. Now there is much more details, and they are telling this to the audience, to the normal people who doesn't know even motorcycle.
Yeah, it's definitely a different world, I think, and we can see how that professionalism going up in the championship, I think, is reflected in how many parts of the world see the sport as well. But we'll go back to one thing you said a minute ago, which is you would not want to be back on the track now. Talk to us a little bit about retirement and how it feels when that's been your life, and then suddenly you decide, okay, now I'm going to stop. And I'm going to do something different, and how you adjust to that. From obviously from Superbike as well, not just from MotoGP, from riding.
Let's talk about stop riding machine when I was still professional. So that's back to to 2012. Well, now for me it was again different, because normally when rider decides to stop, normally you plan to stop, because everyone tried to make the way out as best as possible, And for me, it was a great opportunity, which is, it was that day in Le Mans, Manicourt, because it was the last race. It was the year that I won the title. And I said, I have one more year contract, so better to stop now, because I won for 0.5 points, which is nothing. And I said, that's make me think, So I was already 41. So it was a great opportunity to leave this world with the best memories possible as a world champion of this category. Why not? I lost the income of the year after, which is very important, but that was not the main one. So for me, it was the best solution is to leave a very good image and memory about me riding a machine. And that was a great opportunity. So right now, if I have to think to go back, even my mind cannot be that smart to image myself inside of the field, of course. But I do ride sometimes because I love riding. And when I riding, I have opportunity, I push to go as fast as I can. But normally, when you are almost 50 years of age like me, you think you're going the limits, but you don't.
The limits change. When you did retire, and you, it's almost like you did almost a similar thing what Nico Rosberg did in F1. You won the title and you bowed out on top. Did how because you had a darker experience, obviously, in at the end of 2005, where you didn't have a MotoGP contract and you didn't have anything lined up for 2006. So when you did it feel more of a relief or an achievement to bow out whilst you're on top in a world championship because of your experience previously?
Well, the decision was made at first to myself, because when I was in the MotoGP, I always have a very good team. If it's not factory team, top team. And to go I have opportunity to go on a private team, which have a good bike, but not that good. And I was seeing myself in the position where I have no great chance to be fighting for the top three. So automatically, I'm not interested to do this. So even if I have that opportunity in 2005, 2006, I regret. I said, no, well, better to go with a top team, a factory team, which is give you the chance to perform at high level. So when this opportunity went off, so I said, okay, 2006, I stay home and I reconsider it. And then it was a chance for me to go back on riding with a superbike, which was another world, completely different, but really enjoyed it.
So you did though, you say you retired full time. You did briefly come back. What tempted you to do that? I think was it 2015 or 16? I think 15.
15.
Yeah. What tempted you to do that? Was it just, well, there's no pressure. I've proved my point. It's not my full-time job and see what it brought.
Well, they're realistic for first of all, because I was still in love of this kind of feeling. I will not say work, but I will say sport and feeling, which is you know, the adrenaline, which is the real fuel of the sport, you know, for riders. When I was packing for the two wildcards in 2015, it was just because it was, again, for me, opportunity to prove myself that I still can do it. So after 2 years, 2.5 years of my last race, for me, it was a goal to be back on the world superbike and race in the top five. And it wasn't easy because I lost so many automatics, which is I didn't know. And then when I did the race, even if in the practice on qualify was fast, but in the race again it was different. You know, I was not feeling everything under control when I'm side by side with other riders. So it's again, you lost something if you're not racing every month, every 2 weeks. So, but when I finally did my second race, which is realistic, was my last race in Sepang, and achieved the podium, again, I have a strange feeling because I was 44 years old, still on podium on World Superbike, and I watch on the podium, Johnny Rea was winning. He was 26 years old, and same age of 27, Chad Davis, which was second, and me 44. what a minute. Something's wrong here. I should be here. So, and then I said, okay, this is my last one. But I was happy.
And so you mentioned at the beginning there about you still had that same love of the sport. What, talk to us a little bit about your passion for motorcycle racing, because you had a very long career in world championships. For any rider, they'd be very, very happy to be a world championship rider, Grand Prix, World Superbikes for that amount of time. But did the aspects and the specific things in racing that you love change over that time compared to when you were 250 world champions, then in World Superbikes?
Yeah, you know what? Now I will tell something that I never said. You know, what I really love, it's, you know, the job that there is inside of your team when you're prepared to go into the, you know, you're making, like, let's say it, you go into the war and you have all your people that make a strategy and everything, and buy the bike and the setup and the track and the condition tire and everything. And then you go for the race one, for the first round, when you stop during the winter, and then you go again for the race one, then you make your debut. So that's what is my main, how you say it, something that make me really give me the adrenaline. When you stop for a few months and then you go back and you prepare, maybe also you change team or bike or whatever, and then you put yourself in the position, then you need to do it, race one or the first attempt Grand Prix. So this is for me. And many years, 94, 95, 96, 97, 98, all the first race, if you check, I won for 5 years consecutive, even if I changed class. Because I'm kind of a maniac of working behind the scene. You know?
Uh-huh. That preparation beforehand.
Yes. Yeah, that was my, you know.
So let's talk a little bit about some of maybe your favorite moments then. Can you pick out maybe three from your career that you'd say were your favorite moments, and tell us why, of course. You can choose any championship, Superbike also.
Okay, first of all, you know, I need to say the first time that I did the world championship in Barcelona in 1994, the first time I became world champion, because it was my really first time, was my goal after a few years, and it was the really first time for the manufacturer that I was racing with, Aprilia. So all together was a fantastic moment. And the second, well, I will pick up the Suzuka 500, you know. Suzuka, the debut in the main class, and the winning in Japan with a private team, which is still unreal, but we, and with our kind of model, all the team, we make it happen. And the third, I don't know. I will say the first title in Superbike in 2010. But also, something that really make me feel special. Then I don't know why. I don't know how I did it. The wheeling in Brno.
Yeah, that's so famous, man.
That's happened.
Yeah. That's something I wanted to ask you there about how many titles you got in 250. First thing I wanted to ask is about how you had your whole childhood until you were a grown man at 18, anonymous, normal childhood. But then in your motorcycle racing career, you were so quickly shot to stardom, like a major celebrity. Like you, in today's terms, you were a real, you know, proper celebrity in tabloid papers and stuff like that in Italy. What was that like? Just going from being a normal person to within a space of 4 or 5 years, like a national icon. How did you get around that?
No, well, it just happened, and
yeah.
I guess this is what is gonna happen to all the team that will have success in what they're doing. I was young, I was not prepared, and of course, what it make me, you know, always stay with my feet in the ground was my family. That's the biggest help, you know. They make me the opportunity to do in this world, but also they make me stay, you know, as a normal kid, so normal guy, because the kind of education that I had is helped me out. And plus, you know, I honestly I'm a very simple person. That's why I'm never, you know, my head, it doesn't go in the hair, because, you know, I'm always close to the normal people in reality. And okay, I have also friends, maybe a celebrity, but that also people need to understand that even a celebrity, most of them are very normal, you know. And so depends on which one you choose.
Yeah.
That's good. I like that perspective. That makes a lot of sense. So one more thing then, obviously, now you're still in the paddock, although now as team owner, how is that different? And has your favorite thing about MotoGP changed? Is it still that preparation and then going to that first race, or now in your new position, is it something completely different?
Yeah, well, no, to be ready for preparation race one, that's not the same, because in the Moto3 class, you know, everybody have the same equipment and everybody have the same tires, so it's more up to the riders, you know. So team can help you out, but basically it's more about riders. So to be back, you know, to have a team in the world championship, of course it's a different to be a rider like before. But also I now realize when I jump, for example, Thursday, I go on the track, and when I go out of Thursday night, I see that the day it goes so fast, you know. Always I'm there with a team, maybe with the riders, or to do something with computer and organize team, but actually the time runs so fast and you don't really enjoy the preparation for the weekend. Or the big point is gonna be only the race, you know, the race on Sunday. That's the time where everybody sits in the garage, on the front of the TV, or on the start line, and you feel it's a race day. But before, you just preparation work, you know, your head down, and you're very concentrated.
It sounds like you've applied your love of the preparation beforehand as a racer into your team as well. Is that right?
Well, you know, it's a different point of view, because to be like maniac of preparation, I can do with my team and stuff. Just to prepare the bike as best as possible, or to have a track or hospitality with all the details done, to offer to my sponsor the best, you know, welcome as possible. It's a different point of view now, but again, team survive if they make with the riders the result, and it's, we are all you know, into this, so we need to make the best out of it. But as a team owner, we need also to have a ride in good shape, so to make a good combination.
So like you said, success is key when you're a team and you're a non-factory team as well. You have had a lot of success with your team already. How does that feel? How does it feel when you win, but you're not the rider anymore? Is it that same emotion or...?
Well, in the same, it's very nice emotion, no doubt, but different, of course, because you are not, you know, you're not in the position to cross the start and finish line and to deal with the, but yeah, but I feel when my riders do this, I feel kind of the same, because we are part of the family, and with the rider we make this happen. So I'm very happy, and I'm very thankful also to Aaron Cané, which he did a great year last year with us, and he put himself and my team in such a great spot. So to finish the year one is in the second position is a privilege. You know, we had a great chance last year to win, but finally we did a second, which is great result. Of course, now the expectation is very high, because if you debut and you're already second, you know, you think the next one you're going to be the one, but it doesn't work this way. So. Yeah, yeah.
And it, of course, in your role as a team manager, yeah, I guess you'll be giving sort of personal career advice to your riders too. Something I'm always interested in from your perspective, given how successful you were in the intermediate class, times are different than they are now. The dynamic of the three world championships together is different. But what advice would you like to give to your riders? Do you think people go leave the intermediate class too early to try to get to MotoGP now?
Well, you know, everyone, they have like on front of their face, the MotoGP. MotoGP is the way to go, and they try to make as short as possible the way to. But I really think, you know, I prefer the rider who succeeds in one category and then move on. You know, that's what I prefer. And if not, there is so many others who just run into the MotoGP and without really getting the result that maybe they, if they stay one more year, maybe they can achieve. So to the riders, it's very particular, because riders head it's not that easy as head. And of course, I can give them some advice, and especially if they somehow they ask me. I don't want to just push them to do what I want to do. So yeah. I want let them do it what they think, to let them free. Of course, watching data with the crew chief and so on, we can, as a technician, understand why things happen, but I prefer that the team crew, the chief mechanic, talk to the rider and try to explain them by watching data. And if they need another explanation, another wording, I can talk to them very, very open. So, but I don't want to force them and to feel that I was the one who made it, so you should do this. No.
I imagine the guys you have in Moto3 and any Moto3 rider maybe wouldn't respond the best if someone just came in going, well, you need to do this.
Yeah, of course. Of course, it's not the best way. Even also they're young. When you're younger, you're very spontaneous. So, you know, you need to understand, you know, that you're working with, let's say, young kids. You know, because they are 16, 17, 18, they are very young, you know. And most of these people are, they go to the school, they still go to the school, they are with the family. So it's, you know, it's not so easy.
Yeah, it's a very difficult sort of balance to manage, I suppose. Well, okay, so we want to finish off the podcast with a little quickfire round. So just a few either or option questions for you. So thank you for Kenwood for the Kenwood quickfire round, of course, we call it. So are you ready for, it's just 11 questions for either or quickfire as just the first thing that comes to your mind, okay?
Yeah.
Okay, so, okay, after you, Fran.
Okay, we start easy. Coffee or tea?
Coffee.
Of course.
What's better, first podium or first win?
First podium? Oh, mamma mia. So, but the question is, when it was my first podium?
No, which do you prefer?
No.
What feels better?
Which is a better feeling? Don't worry. Okay. It's not a quiz about you. Like.
Okay. First podium, yeah, I would say the Barcelona 1994.
Okay.
And then first win, it's the same.
It's just as good. Okay.
Oh, yeah. So, which do you prefer? I've realised before that I put the wrong comparison here. So, it's Milan or Naples? Milano or Napoli?
Well, let's say Milano, because there is many things to do.
It's a fair answer. Do you prefer summer or winter?
I will say summer.
Mugello or Mezzano?
Mugello.
Always. What's your favourite film?
Well, Captain America.
Oh, yeah? Interesting.
Yeah.
Cool, I like it. Good choice.
Because there is a... Not only because there is a, it's a Marvel studio, but because behind there is a thing that make you thinking that there's not then the dream can come true, you know, by an accident. Of course, you know the story of Captain America.
Yeah. Yeah.
But this guy is really want. He was desperate to do it, but mm-hmm. he didn't have the physical, you know.
Interesting. Nice.
So I like that.
It has a deeper meaning for you. Nice. Okay.
Big Captain America fan here. Good answer. So, pizza or pasta?
Pasta.
What was your most unexpected win?
Whoa. Most unexpected win. Oh. That's crazy. Most unexpected win. I have no idea.
I've got a possible answer for you. What about was it 2003 Donington that you won?
That was fun.
Was that unexpected?
That was fun because no, really not, because there was a sanction of Rossi who did something under yellow flags.
Yeah.
I didn't expect that. Yeah, that's true. So it was Donington 2003. Yes.
Did you realize when you came into Parc Fermé or?
They told me. They told me when not in the Parc Fermé, when I ran to the step to the podium.
Mm-hmm. Okay. Okay, cool. What's the scariest or craziest crash that you've had on a motorcycle?
Well, I have to say something was really crazy. Australia 2008, at the end of the straight at 300 kilometers per hour. Yes, that was the craziest one.
That was when, which bike were you on there? Ducati?
Oh, yes, that was crazy.
Mm-hmm. What was your favourite on-track moment? A particular pass, crossing the flag moment? Take your choice, take your pick.
I have to say something crazy. Not unexpected, but almost 2007, Vallelunga Superbike. When we went into the one big corner in four of us, top four, and I was the last. And I become, at the end of this corner, I just was first. That was crazy. You know? If you watch this maneuver, it was, well, if I tried to do 10 times, maybe I cannot even do it.
So I think this is the last one. What was more fun to ride, the Aprilia 250 Grand Prix machine or Aprilia Superbike?
Wow. So by emotion, Aprilia 250, because it was a disc valve. It was, it was a very, very rare machine. Mm-hmm. Because now we can say this after so many years. of course, the Aprilia Superbike, when it came out, it was something really so far on technique, on technology, then it made me feel like I'm running something special. But of course, it's two different things. So yeah, if I have to pick up one, Aprilia 250.
Awesome. Well, thank you for that, your quick fire answers, Max. Before we just start to wrap up then, I just wanted to ask quickly, because it always fascinated me growing up, the iconic number three. Aprilia have always been big on their small capacity machines, so like your 125s, your scooters, and a lot of them had so many replicas of your liveries on them. How does that feel, having such a widespread sort of footprint across the motorcycle community? Because I had friends growing up who had Max Biaggi replica Aprilia 125s. Is that something that you ever thought about?
Well, still now I received so many pictures from people, fans around the world. They still have this replica 125, 250 scooter. So I think that long time ago, Aprilia spread a lot of a scooter bikes with this livre, and it make me feel old. but also, in somehow, then for that year, it make me feel privileged, because everyone like to be a Corsaro from the 250, which is have the black bike with the yellow helmets. So this is a kind of a print that always will remind in my memory, and also in the fan memories.
Excellent. Okay, cool. Just I always wanted to know that. It's something very curious. Well, thank you very much for your time. Really appreciate
you.
It. And loving the IG lives as well. Keep those up, even on the quarantine.
We will try. You know, it's not easy, because it's not easy asking people to do this, because in a way you always ask, you know, when you ask, I don't like really. So if something come out automatically, it's okay. But to keep doing it is very difficult, because this is like journalist job. But it's not so easy. Welcome.
Yeah, it's tough, isn't it?
But it was nice, because one, I really appreciate that he won with Wayne Rainey. And it's so emotional to talk to Wayne about the old memories and so on. And also with the two, in the same day, in 1 hour, I did half an hour with the both Troy Corson and Troy Bayliss. Were very nice. Very,
awesome.
Very nice.
Amazing.
I like
stories.
That. Both Troys. We all know who you mean.
Well, okay. Well, we'll let you go then, and we'll get ready. Well, allow you to prep for your next one. So, really appreciate it, and speak to you soon.
Yes, yes, thanks so much.
Have a good one.
Bye now.
Ciao.
Well, thanks a lot, Max, for your valuable time. Sorry to drag him away from doing those almost iconic Instagram lives, as we mentioned there. So Max is not actually the only real star of the sport that we got coming up on the show over the next couple of weeks as well. Of course, we've already had some stars of the show. I mean, you got Twitter celebrity Alex Briggs we had before, but can't quite reveal who we have coming up on the show next week just yet, because actually there's quite a host of different high-profile candidates, I should say.
Yes, there are. Although candidates makes it sound like they're desperately applying. Obviously, it's
CVs.
More organising everything as we all continue in lockdown. Can be a bit of a challenge, I'm sure you all understand. But audiovisual lockdown edition of Last on the Breaks will return again next week with, yes, hopefully another legend of the sport, current or previous.
Yes. Well, you'll have to tune in to find out who it is. Hope you guys have been enjoying this one. And of course, please leave us a comment or rate a review on whichever podcast platform you're listening on. Leave a comment on the YouTube video. Let us know what you liked, what you didn't like. Be nice to us, please. And the guests as well, I suppose. Give us some feedback and let us know who you actually want to see on the podcast. Because although we have some names that we've already got written down, maybe there's somebody else who we've not thought of yet who's just sitting, bored, waiting on lockdown, ready for a 40-minute chat with myself and Fran.
Absolutely. It is an unimaginable treat in these dark times. But no, sarcasm aside, we hope that you are all doing okay during these times and we're managing to lift your spirits a little bit with these interviews. Thank you very much for listening and hopefully we'll be back with you again next week.
Bye.